Because at the end of the Beatitudes, Jesus tells us that we don't need to worry about what others may be saying about us as long as we are doing the work of God. Just let them call you a fool. In Matthew 5, 11 to 12, we hear, "Blessed are you when they insult you and persecute you and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven. They persecuted the prophets who were before you." In other words, let them call you a fool, because you ain't the first fool for the Lord, and you sure won't be the last. So if they want to call you a fool, let them call you a fool, because this fool done made some good money off all them people that used to call me a fool. You know, the prophets were considered to be fools. The apostles were called fools. The early church fathers were even called fools. All of the saints were foolish in the eyes of the world. So if I must be considered a fool, then at least I know I'm going to be in some good company when I get to the kingdom of heaven. You know, my brothers and sisters, Scripture tells us, consider your own calling, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. Rather, God chose the foolish of the world to shame the wise. And God chose the weak of the world to shame the strong. And God chose the lowly and the despised of the world, those who count for nothing, to reduce to nothing those who are something, so that no human being might boast before God. Indeed, we are blessed to be who we are. We are blessed to be about the business of God. We are blessed to be called His fools. You know, I've been so blessed in many ways, and I always laugh now because there's something that's going to be happening, hopefully by the end of the summer, that's going to be my chance to stand up and giggle at everybody. Because, as they said in the introduction, Cynthia Capen and Capen Communication has been filming for the last 4.5 years a documentary about this happy priest from New Orleans. And so we need everybody, I don't know who's the saint in charge of HBO, but we need y'all to start praying hard so that the documentary indeed will be picked up by HBO, just because there have been so many people who thought that this boy right here was crazy. I just want to be in their living room and see their face when I show up on their TV. The film is actually, we're blessed, it's being finished over at the Sony Studios, so it's going to be good. And then, of course, hopefully by Christmas, you can buy one for you, your mama, and your cousin Pookie. But, you know, it's so crazy, you know, because I love getting a chance to do what I do. And one of the greatest gifts I have now is when I travel, I get a chance to bring some of my people with me. You know, not that somebody else pays for it, because I still got to find the money. But for years now, I've been traveling with a phenomenal minister of Christ, one of the deepest and just most in-depth spirits that God could ever use, a guy named Paul Flores. And I know that some of y'all know Paul. Paul has that ability. He's from Lubbock, Texas. Paul, when we travel together, you know, Paul is my interpreter for the Spanish folk, because like I'll say it in my accent, and then he translates from English, from my accent to English to Spanish. And then he'll say something, and I got to translate for the other folk too. So we make such a great team. But you can't get somebody with a deeper spirit and somebody who truly understands what it means to be a fool, because God will choose the foolish to shame the wise, and He's got a testimony, I'm telling you. But this trip, I also have one of the greatest gifts I've ever had, because this year, I brought my brother with me. Isn't that like cool? Isn't that like so cool? And since I'm the baby of my family, it's always good when your brother got to walk around and say, "Yeah, that's my brother." That's joy right there. That's joy. And so y'all will see him walking around. You know he's me because we got the same forehead. You know that's my brother. Because we're not going bald. We have a receding hairline. His is almost to his neck. And so, but I love traveling with my brother because you know, I always tell folk, you know, like you know, my brother, he's actually a streetcar driver in New Orleans, the historic streetcars. And so he talk like that all the time. Yeah, I don't know if y'all can imagine in our family, ain't nobody ever shut up, but that's another story. But you know, one day my brother was in his bus, and he was driving down, you know, one of the streets in New Orleans on his way towards the zoo. And as he was driving the bus along, and he was driving along, he noticed a truck in front of him that had stopped. And you know, the guy was waving him down and flagging him over. And so my brother pulled the big city bus over, and he opened up the bus door and said, "Man, there's something I could do to help you." And the man said, yeah, I need help, I need help. He said, "What's the matter?" He said, "Look, I've got like a truck full of penguins that I'm trying to get to the zoo. But the problem is yeah, man, I can't get the truck going." I said, my brother said, "Man, what would you want me to do?" He said, "Man, can you just take the penguins to the zoo?" And my brother said, "Man, look, this is a city bus. I can't take the penguins to the zoo." And the man said, "Look, I'll give you $100 if you will take these penguins to the zoo. Just give you $100 to take the penguins to the zoo." So, you know, being my brother, of course, he was going to take the money. And so he said, "Well, all right." So the man opened up the back of the truck, and the little penguins all came out. They all got up on the bus. They put on their little seat belts. They sat down. They were ready. And so the bus is heading now to the zoo. Well, about an hour and a half later, the truck driver saw the bus coming back. So he waved my brother down, and when the bus stopped, the truck driver noticed that all the penguins were still on the bus. And the man said, "Man, I thought I gave you $100 to bring these penguins to the zoo." And my brother said, "I did. We got money left over. We're going to the movies." One more. One day, my brother and I found ourselves standing at the judgment seat. And when we got into heaven, you know, we were all excited because, you know, first God took me to my house because, you know, I'm Father Tony. Surely I'll get to my house first. And so when he brought me to my house, you know, I liked it. It was beautiful, a nice little mansion God had designed. And then he said, "Well, you know, Father Tony, we're going to take you with your brother Kevin so you can see his house." You know, because Kevin was a pretty good man, a wonderful bus driver down in New Orleans. And when we got to my brother's house, he had this big, giant mansion, like 20 stories in the air. And, I mean, it was gorgeous. And I was like, "Excuse me, Lord, I'm a priest of God. I done celibacy all these years. How is it possible that my brother got a bigger house than me? I'm the priest. He the bus driver." He said, "Well, I'll tell you why. Because you see, when you preached, people slept. When he drove, people prayed."